वेलकम विथ ऑल, दिस इज माई लेक्चर नंबर 8 फॉर द कोर्स PE-414। इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस द इफेक्ट ऑफ वेटेबिलिटी ऑन द रिकवरी ऑफ हाइड्रोकार्बन ड्यूरिंग द वाटर इंजेक्शन इन अ नेचुरली फ्रैक्चर्ड रिजर्वायर। एंड वी हैव सीन दैट व्हेन वी हैव द वाटर वेट रिजर्वायर, द स्पॉन्टेनियस इम्ब्यूशन विल बी ग्रेट एंड मेजॉरिटी ऑफ द हाइड्रोकार्बन विल बी रिकवर्ड थ्रू द स्पॉन्टेनियस इम्ब्यूशन। And basically the capillary forces are so strong that water will be imbibed spontaneously and hydrocarbons will be recovered. And we have seen that for spontaneous imbibition, basically we have to inject water at a low rate. And we have seen that when we inject water at a low rate, water will be imbibed greatly in your matrix and majority of the hydrocarbons will be recovered. So injection rate should be low for an effective spontaneous imbibition. For a mixed wet or oil wet reservoirs, we have seen that we have to basically take use of the forced imbibition and we have to recover hydrocarbons through the forced imbibition. And we have seen that forced imbibition is like the drainage process. And we have seen that the matrix structure fluid exchange will occur during the flow towards the well. And the matrix fluid exchange depends on all these parameters. What are the characteristics of your rock and the fluids? Again, the wettability is very important, the fluid density is very important, viscosity is also very important. What are the fluid types and saturation in matrix? What are the fluid types and saturation in fractures? And what are the driving force? Gravity and or capillarity. And obviously, driving force depends on whether you have the spontaneous imbibition or the combination of spontaneous and gravity mechanism or the gravity dominated flow. So again, wettability is very important, and wettability basically again link with your fluid in the matrix and fluid in the fractures. And obviously we have seen this slide, and basically we have seen that when we study the water injection in this oil reservoir, which is a naturally fractured reservoir, we take use of the imbibition curves. For water wet reservoir, basically we have the spontaneous imbibition. For mixed wet, we have the combination of both spontaneous and the forced imbibition. And for strongly oil wet reservoir, we only have the forced imbibition. And forced imbibition is just like a drainage process, because the saturation of the wetting phase is being reduced by injection of a null wetting phase. So for oil wet, water is null wetting. Basically we have also seen that in a given reservoir, for example, if you are injecting gas from the top section or injecting water from the bottom section, so in a different reservoir basically you will have different processes happening simultaneously. So in the top section you will have the gravity drainage process, because gas is null wetting and displacing the oil which is wetting. So this process, the displacement of oil by gas can be represented through the drainage process, and the displacement of oil by water should be represented through the imbibition process. And basically when gas is displacing your oil, we take use of this drainage curve. And for drainage curve, we know that there is a threshold pressure, the pressure above which you will have the recovery, below which you will not have any recovery. So if you have a matrix block, so height of the matrix block should be linked to your drainage capillary pressure curve. So there should be a threshold height, and that height basically below which you will not have any oil recovery. So that zone is called the capillary hold up zone. So this is a disadvantage of your drainage process, that there is a zone in the reservoir or in the block which will not be recovered by your injected fluid, because the hydrocarbons or the oil in this zone will be retained inside the block because of the high capillary forces. And as you can see that in this process, gas has been injected and gas basically is simultaneously moving from the top section of the block, and basically you recover first the top section and then bottom section and continue the recovery till point number 3. And below point number 3, the gas cannot invade and cannot remove hydrocarbon or oil from this zone, because the capillary pressure is so high that the driving force, which is the difference between Pg minus P naught, is lower. The delta P basically the Pg minus P naught, the gas pressure minus the oil pressure. So in this capillary hold up zone, the driving force is lower as compared to the threshold pressure. So the hydrocarbon or oil in this zone cannot be recovered and will remain there. This is the disadvantage of the drainage process, that some of the hydrocarbons or oil will be retained in your block. Obviously, it depends on the matrix block height. So if you have a great height, a portion of that will be not recovered by this gas injection. And but if the matrix block height is lower, the retain zone or the capillary hold up zone size will be appreciable as compared to the block size. So basically, when you are injecting gas to recover oil, basically it is a drainage process, and the top of the matrix block is the reference level. Generally, we assume that the side faces of the block are impermeable. The gas front position is at a distance right from the reference plane, which is the top section, and the block height is H, and the threshold height is HTH. So basically, this is a threshold height, and obviously it varies from the curves to curves. So threshold pressure basically changes from the rocks to rock. So it's not a fixed thing. It basically depends on various parameter like the permeability, the pore sizes. So if you have the lower permeability, for example the C section, the permeability of that rock is lower as compared to B and A. So as you can see, that threshold height for C is higher as compared to B and A. So threshold height basically changes from rock to rock. So as you can see in this basically curve, you have a fixed threshold height. This is a drainage curve which has been developed in the lab for that bore, and by using the reservoir oil and the injected gas. So this drainage curve basically generated in the lab, and in this slide you can see the effect of various block heights on the capillary hold up zone. So if the block size is lower than your threshold height, you will not recover any oil from your matrix block, because the pressure, the driving force, which is Pg minus P naught, never exceed this threshold pressure, and no oil is recovered from your block. Similarly, if you have a higher size or higher height block, you will have some recovery, and basically the oil of this zone whose height is above your threshold height will be recovered. And this is the capillary hold up zone where the oil is retained by your matrix because of the higher capillary forces. Similarly, if the height increases, as you can see, you recover some of the oil whose height is above your threshold height. Even in this top section, you can see there will be some residual oil. Again, this oil basically is retained in the top section where the gas has entered and recovered majority of the hydrocarbon. So this basically oil is retained in the reservoir because of the various parameter, pore sizes and pore geometry and other things. This block has the highest height among all the other blocks, and as you can see that the size of the capillary hold up zone as compared to its original height is lower. So majority of the hydro oil of this block has been recovered. So for drainage curve, basically you wish that the block size in the reservoir are high, But for imbibition, we will see that you will wish that the block size for imbibition process should be small, because for imbibition we want an effective contact between our water and our matrix. So smaller the block size for imbibition, effective imbibition will take place and hydrocarbons or oil from the block will be recovered. But for drainage curve, the height should be at least higher than this threshold height. So if the block height is lower than this threshold height, you will not have any recovery. Higher the block height, higher the recovery you will have from the reservoir. So capillary hold up zone is very important to basically decide which type of injected fluid you should choose. Definitely you want to choose that injected fluid which has lower capillary hold up zone or minimum capillary hold up zone. As I have mentioned that this threshold height basically changes with permeability, with the type of injected fluid, with the difference of density between your injected fluid and the reservoir oil. So many times you can play with this threshold height by changing your injected fluid. You cannot change the reservoir properties, but you can change the injected fluid properties. So by changing the injected fluid properties, many times you can play with this threshold height in the drainage curve. So while designing an injected fluid for the drainage process, you have to keep in mind that this capillary hold up zone should be lower as possible. Again, as you can see that in this slide, basically there are three cores A, B and C. Each has this different permeability, so at each has different permeability, so as the threshold height. And for example, if we assume that reservoir block size or height are same, you can see that you will have the maximum recovery for this A capillary pressure curve, because the threshold height is smaller. So you will have the capillary hold up zone smaller in this A core or rock. For B rock, you have the higher capillary hold up zone as compared to the A rock. So you can see that you recover some oil from this B rock, but you have some residual oil or the oil that hasn't been recovered by your injected gas in this B rock. In C rock, basically the matrix block height is equal to your threshold height, which means that in C rock you will not recover any oil, because the driving force do not exceed your threshold pressure. So the hydrocarbons or oil in this C rock has not been recovered by your injected gas. So definitely you have to basically design such a fluid that recover majority of your oil from your matrix in a naturally fractured reservoir. For example, this basically explains how gas cap moves inside the reservoir. Your reservoir is composed of matrix blocks, and the matrix block are surrounded by your fractures. So when you injecting gas in the gas cap, so gas cap expansion basically occurring, and the gas is moving from your gas cap inside your reservoir, and the matrix block are being surrounded by your gas. And again you will have the drainage process occurring in each block, and basically all the blocks will have a drainage capillary pressure curve, and according to the drainage capillary pressure curve you will have a threshold height. So accordingly, if the matrix block height is higher than your threshold height, you will have the recovery. And obviously, if the height of the block is lower than the threshold height, you will not have any recovery. So as you can see, in all the blocks, you will have some recoveries, and majority of the oil is retained in the matrix, because only those oil can be recovered where the pressure of the gas exceed the threshold pressure. So the concept of capillary continuity arises. So if you consider that blocks are isolated, each block will have a separate drainage capillary pressure curve. So accordingly, you will have a separate recovery for each block, which is independent from the other block, and obviously the height of that block will be related to the threshold height. But if the blocks are continuous and have connectivity, a single drainage capillary pressure curve will be applied for all these connected blocks. And since the blocks are connected now, total height of this stacked blocks is higher than the individual block height, which means the capillary holdup zone will be small in this continuous block reservoir as compared to the individual block reservoir. So with connectivity and continuity, you will have the highest recovery in the reservoir as compared to when the blocks are not connected to each other. Obviously, to some extent, the blocks will be connected to each other in the reservoir. So because of this connectivity, the efficiency of the gravity drainage process will increase, as you have the one capillary holdup zone in the bottom section of the reservoir as compared to the capillary holdup zone in each individual block. So the recovery when the blocks are discontinuous is lower as compared to the case when you have the connectivity. So this also need to be considered, or this also need to be ensured in reservoir while designing any gas for the oil recovery. So for imbibition case, basically when we are injecting water inside the reservoir, or water from the water aquifer is invading in the oil zone, we will have one of these condition in the reservoir. Either we will have the water completely surrounding our matrix, or water basically partially surround our matrix. We will see that basically it depends on the rate of invasion or the injection rate of water. So if the injection rate of water is higher, and the water will quickly surround the matrix, and if the injection rate is smaller, water slowly moves through the fractures and will surround the matrix at some later stage. Obviously, it also depends on the wettability of the matrix. If the matrix is water wet, obviously this water will move inside the matrix and will not move through the fractures. And if the matrix is oil wet, this water will first surround the matrix and then will invade into the matrix, just like the gas invasion in the oil matrix. So when we have the oil matrix, which means the matrix is oil wet, the process will be like a drainage process, and water will invade in the oil matrix through the pressure. basically we have seen this slide again and again, and we have seen that water basically flows through the fractures. If you're injecting water, and water will initially fill the fracture, and according to the wettability, water will be imbibed by the matrix, and at the imbibition place you will have the counter current exchange mechanism. Water is being imbibed and oil is being released, and this oil basically is moving through the fractures towards the production well. So if the matrix is the water wet, you will have the spontaneous imbibition, and water will have resistance to flow. Water will not flow very quickly, and you will have the breakthrough of water at some later stage. So effectiveness of water injection will increase when you have the strongly water wet reservoir. Obviously, when the water is non-wetting, the imbibition process will not occur, and water will flow quickly through the fractures and will have an early breakthrough. So basically, this is basically the figure that shows that when you inject water through the fractures, water will basically imbibe in the matrix, and basically after this water is being imbibed in the matrix, the hydrocarbons or oil is released in the fracture by the matrix, and this oil is taken by the fracture towards the production well. Obviously at some point in time you will have imbibition process completes, and you will have the breakthrough of water along with the oil. So what is counter current and co-current? Basically, counter current means that water and oil flow through the same phases in opposite direction. So for example, water is being imbibed into the matrix, and oil is being released to the matrix in the same phase of the block, then it is called the counter current mechanism or the counter current flow, because the direction of the invasion and the flow coming from the matrix are opposite to each other. In co-current flow, basically water is being imbibed in one direction and oil is being released by the matrix from the other direction, from the other phase in the same direction. So when water and flow through the opposite phases in the same direction, then this type of flow is called the co-current flow. So basically, if your block is completely immersed in the water, so you can see that water is being imbibed and oil is being released from the same phase in opposite direction. As you can see, water is being imbibed in this matrix from the all sides, and oil is being released out of the matrix from the all sides, and direction of both oil and water are opposite to each other. So this type of flow is called the counter current flow. And for example, water is being imbibed from the one phase and oil is being released from the another phase in the same direction, then this type of flow is called the co-current imbibition. Again, some of the oil basically is being released which is counter current with respect to this water being imbibed, but we have to see the majority of the oil. So if the majority of the oil is being released in the same direction as the water is being imbibed, then this type of flow is called the co-current flow. And as you can see, for example, if we are injecting water at a low rate, so water basically has a time to get contact with your matrix, and an effective spontaneous imbibition will occur in this matrix block, and water level in the fracture will rise slowly. So at lower rates you will have the co-current imbibition or the co-current flow. So at the low injection rate of water you will have the co-current flow, which means you will have no counter current flow or the minimum counter current flow. At higher rates, basically you will have both co-current and counter current flow. For example, in this case, as you can see, one of the phase has not been immersed by the water or surrounded by the water. So water is being imbibed in the three phases of this matrix block, and oil is being released from these three sides. So in these three sides you have the counter current imbibition, but for this side which hasn't yet completely surrounded by the water, you have the co-current flow or the co-current imbibition. Obviously a time will come when all of the sides of the block will be surrounded by the water and you will have the counter current imbibition. At very high rate, obviously you do not have an effective spontaneous imbibition, and the water will sooner or quicker surround this matrix block, and from the earliest time you will have the counter current imbibition. So depending upon the injection rate, depending upon the wettability of the rock, you will have sooner or later counter current imbibition. Even in the case of the low rate, a time will come ultimately your block will be completely surrounded by your injected water and you will have the counter current imbibition. So at early times you will have the co-current imbibition, at later time you will have the counter current imbibition. And basically when we will have the capillary dominated flow or when we will have the gravity dominated flow, basically this factor NB basically is used to calculate the type of the dominated flow in our reservoir. And as you can see in this formula, basically you have the C, interfacial tension, porosity, permeability, density difference, G and H, and C is basically the constant which is depend on the type of the model you are using. Delta rho is a density difference between oil and water. Sigma is the interfacial tension, G is the gravity, phi is the porosity, K is the permeability, and H is the height of the matrix block. So this NB, which is a dimensionless number, is basically used to calculate which type of flow will be dominant in a given condition. And as you can see, when this number is greater than 5, you have the capillary forces dominant and you have the counter current flow. When basically this number is less than 1, you have the gravity forces dominant and you have the co-current flow. And in between 0.2 and 5, both capillary and gravity forces are present and you have the co-current and the counter current flow. So which means that when you have the co-current flow, in this case basically this is a horizontal case, but generally matrix blocks are vertical. So in this co-current flow you have the effect of gravity. The gravity forces are dominant, and when basically you have the counter current flow, you have the effect of the capillary forces. So basically we know that gravity forces exist when you have a difference of density between the two fluids. Since we know that water is denser than your oil, so when both oil and water are flowing, and because of the density, water is behind your oil, either in the fracture or in basically in your matrix. So if the water level is lower and oil is basically is being forced to flow out of this matrix block because of the density difference between oil and water, then this type of flow is called the gravity dominant flow. So when you have the co-current imbibition, you have the gravity dominated flow, and when you have the counter current imbibition, that indicates that you have the capillary dominated flow. And obviously you have a region where both capillary and the gravity forces are dominant. As you can see, for example, in this diagram, water is being imbibed from the oil direction, oil is being released from the oil direction, and this is the counter current flow, and this flow occurs basically when this dimensional number is greater than 5. Let's drive an equation for the imbibition of water in the matrix of an NFR, and basically we will drive a general equation where we will assume that both gravity and the capillary forces are present, and then we will be running some special cases when we assume that only capillary forces are dominant, and we will run a case when we assume that only gravity forces are dominant. So in order to drive the equation for the imbibition of water inside a matrix, basically we have assumed that the side walls of this matrix block are impermeable, and the water that can imbibe or can enter into this matrix block through the bottom face, and the oil basically can be recovered from the faces. So water can only be entered through the faces, and oil can only be come out from the matrix block through the faces only. H is the height of the matrix block, H naught basically height of the oil zone in the fracture, HW is the height of the water zone in the fracture, Z is the height of the water invasion in the matrix, and H minus Z basically is the matrix non-invaded zone height, or the height basically occupied by the oil at a given time. So obviously as the time changes, this Z will increase, which means that the volume or the height occupied by the invaded water will increase, and obviously with time this H minus Z will decrease. As more and more water invades into the matrix, oil will be recovered through the faces. So we have assumed that the matrix block is assumed as a cylinder where lateral walls are coated so that fluid exchange will take place only through the lower or the upper face of the block. The water table could rise at a given height HW, which correspond to the total fracture oil height H naught, so that the block height can be expressed as H block is equal to HW plus H naught. For example, if we want to calculate the recovery that we will recover from this matrix block by the water invasion, recovery factor basically is equal to A Z porosity effective, A is the area of this matrix block, Z is the height occupied by this water, or the water invaded height. Phi is the an effective porosity, basically is the product of the porosity multiplied by this delta S naught, the movable hydrocarbon saturation. And movable hydrocarbon saturation basically is equal to 1 minus SWI minus SOR, where SWI is the Kunate water saturation, and SOR basically the residual oil saturation. So because of this water invasion, there will be some oil that will be left in this invaded zone. So the movable hydrocarbon saturation is equal to 1 minus SWI minus SOR, and when you multiply your movable oil saturation with the porosity, you get the effective porosity, and when you multiply the effective porosity with the volume of the invaded zone, you will get the recovery at a given time. So obviously as Z increases, recovery from this matrix block will increase. So obviously we will see that in the equation we will have a factor of time. So as time increases, this recovery will increase.